Lagos has a population of 22 million people. We generate about 24 million trips, of which 30 million are public transport trips. On average, we spend about 2.5 hours on the road to complete our trips, which is unacceptable. When you look at the amount of money that we waste, especially as a result of congestion, it has been estimated to be close to about $5 billion. Now, that's a lot of money wasted on congestion.
Lamata, based on the studies that have been done, discovered that the best way to solve the problem of public transport we have in Lagos State is to begin to move people en masse. And that is why we now come up with that project, BRT, the first BRT in sub-Saharan Africa.
The increased population of Lagos and then, of course, inefficient transportation system informs the initiation of a bus rapid transit. At that time, it was a bilateral scheme. We call it BRT Light. It was intended to reduce the interference of other vehicles with the bus. And then that was why the project was conceived, so that we had to retrofit, so to say, the existing road between CMS and Mile 12 to accommodate the new BRT scheme.
What route is best for us to start this? And then we look at Ikorodu Road, because Ikorodu Road is 10-lane road.
The Ikorodu Road corridor was chosen as the preferred route to implement the BRT. And that is because it carries a majority of our public transport trips, and it's a strategic route and a gateway out of Lagos too.
Immediately after this project was implemented, we conducted what we call post-implementation review. We discovered that about 15 to 20% people drop their cars. People really embrace the new system and they start using the BRT.
The model that was adopted for the first BRT and by extension for the second BRT is gross contract model. And that model is based on the regulator providing infrastructure, planning, regulation, monitoring and evaluation, and franchising the operation to a private sector who will in turn provide the rolling stock, human capacity for the running of the scheme.
In implementing the BRT along the Ikorodu corridor, we carried out what we call environmental and social due diligence. And the reason for that is because we needed to look at the risk, the environmental and social risk, so that we can incorporate it into the program. So we discovered that there was a lot of encroachment on the right of way. We discovered that we needed to move the utilities on the right of way also, and we needed to manage traffic because it's a very highly dense corridor. We developed a traffic management plan to ensure that during the construction of that corridor, traffic doesn't stop.
The first BRT, actually, we used what we call the state's procurement process to procure the contractor. We used Lagos State fund to implement that project 100%. For the extension, which is the second BRT, we collaborated with World Bank and French Agency Development. So we use World Bank procurement procedure to procure the contractor. And we use what we call international competitive bidding to select the contractor.
Because of the nature of the project and the fact that it was, we require a quick delivery of the project, the corridor was divided into sections, and about four contractors of five were engaged so that the work can start simultaneously. And then they are Sectra Nigeria Limited, we have RCF Nigeria Limited, we have Breco, and we have Lopec, with ITP providing consultancy services for BRT Light scheme. For BRT extensions, we have CCCC is a Chinese, you know, construction company here operating in Nigeria. And under the supervision of AEC, of course, with application for another, you know, foreign consulting firm.
The first BRT, I think we use about 18 months to finish that. And then we started operation on that one 2008. And then the second BRT that we call BRT Classic, we use 2 years, 9 months. That one started in 2012 and it was commissioned in November 2015.
Part of what we did to ensure that people do not become worse off than when we implemented the project was to develop a market, especially for the people who were selling along the corridor. We developed a convenient garage for the NURTW union to move their vehicles and just to ensure that that corridor is cleared.
Since the inception of the first BRT in 2008, under AUTP 1, the system has been able to carry over 300 million passengers. Now, in 2015, the second BRT was implemented under AUTP 2, and that system has been able to carry over 100 million passengers. Altogether, the BRT under AUTP 1 and under AUTP 2 has carried over 400 million passengers from 2008 to date.
Part of the benefit of implementing the BRT is that you know, people along that corridor who traverse that corridor were able to make a savings in the amount they spend on transportation. So, for example, we recorded a savings of about 30% because BRT is much, much cheaper to travel on than the minibuses or other forms of transport along that corridor. Secondly, to traverse that corridor, it takes over 2 hours. That's from Ikorodu to CMS. And with the implementation of the BRT, people were able to save over 30 minutes. So it now takes about 90 minutes to travel from Ikorodu to CMS. Waiting time also went down from about 45 minutes to 10 minutes. And most importantly, the greenhouse gas emission along that corridor was reduced by 14%. We conducted a survey along the corridor to try and understand people's perception of BRT. Over 72% of the people that we interviewed said they enjoyed BRT, they liked the BRT, and they're more likely to use it. So it received a high approval rating.
The BRT model, which is a gross contract model, has achieved a lot of benefit and success for the state government, for the private sector, as well as for the community public. The model has been able to achieve a set of capacity development for the private sector. The model has been able to achieve and enhance LAMATA regulatory function, oversight function for the private sector. And with the implementation of such model, we have been able to attract employing various people to fill various positions. Now, for the first BRT, which was implemented under ATP 1, and the second BRT, the system has been able to employ over 2,000 employees. Another key achievement is the encouragement of private sector participation in government transport initiatives in Lagos.
We learned a lot of lessons from this project. The first one being that, I mean, because we collaborated with a lot of stakeholders, the World Bank, French development agencies, so we share a lot of experiences. We were able to learn a lot from them. We were able to leverage on the experience of World Bank and French development agency, and that helps a lot.
I think one of the lessons learned is that the stakeholder engagement was important to get buy-in from the various groups that were affected by the project.
The first one being that Ikorodu Road was federal government road. The project that we are bringing is states that is handling it. So the first one is for us now to make federal government to buy into our own idea. The second one now is the right of way. We have serious problem with right of way. How do you do this? You have a lot of properties along Ikorodu corridor from TBS to Ikorodu. And then you have a lot of people that have encroached on the right of way. Another issue that we had was the what we call utilities along the same corridor. You have water pipes, you have cables, PHN cables, we have telecoms cables along the corridor.
It's always important to look at all the problems, map out all the problems, and then talk to the various stakeholders. So talking to the ministries who were involved in various aspects of what we had to move was important. We were able to get buy-in very early, and so that did not hinder the duration of the project.
We've learned that political championship is important in the implementation of any transport initiatives. Without a political champion, it will be extremely difficult to pass the vision to the public, to various stakeholders. We also learned that funding is imperative. Without funding, it's difficult to have a means of carrying out the vision of any transport initiative. We also learned that private sector participation is key. The government cannot provide infrastructure as well as run the operation. We need private sector expertise to drive the operation of any transport initiative. It is important to carry the stakeholders along in the implementation of such a scheme.
There was a program of upgrade that was carried out on the BRT, you know, facilities. And the upgrade was carried out on the from Mile 12 to CMS, which, you know, involves the building of a bus depot at K2, you know, Cloverleaf, and also involved the building of about 28 bus shelters and the terminal at TBS. That is under the upgrade. Of course, there are other civil works that was carried out in the bus shelters, which involves rams, guardrail, walkway, you know, solution of dampening roofs on the bus shelters. Of course, there was the need. As the first thing we learned, there was a need to reduce interference with other vehicles. The economic benefit of having the BRT is to reduce travel time. And if the interference with other vehicles is much, definitely we won't achieve the reduction in travel time. And part of the first thing we learned was to reduce travel time in the BRT corridor, because it was actually a segregated, it was traveling under a dedicated lane, so with little or no interference. Of course, we now know then that without interference, it was easy for us to record the considerable, you know, limited time to travel from one origin to a destination. Because the first pavement we adopted under BRT 1 was flexible pavement, and then because of the effect of cyclic loading, we changed BRT, the flexible pavement to rigid pavement in the BRT extension. Of course, the benefit here is that we will not have to revisit the BRT corridors and carry out maintenance work, you know, as quickly as we did under the first BRT. Then, in the BRT extension, we included a passing lane in all our bus stations, because in the first BRT, there was no passing lane because of the constraint of space. But in the second BRT, which is the BRT extension, we had passing lane, which enables buses to actually dock in the bus stations, either offload or pick passengers, while other buses who are on express service can move on without queuing up behind the other buses.
We learned how to plan our project even from the beginning to the end. So be able to know exactly what you are going to do from the start of the project to the end of the project. So we have our milestones, so we have our critical parts, so all these we were able to put on the table even before we start the project. I'm Engineer Abiodun Dabiri, MDC Olamata.
My name is Dr. Frederick Oladende. I'm Director of Corporate and Investment Planning, Lamata, and I'm a transport planner by profession.
My name is Dr. Desmond Amigbewo, the Director of Bus Services, Lamata.